What's going on, everyone? It's time for another tutorial video, and you guessed it, we're talking about building drivable vehicles with the Spatial Creator Toolkit. From sports cars to off-roaders and even futuristic hoverboards, there's all kinds of rides you can add to your spatial teams and experiences. Race your friends around the track, cruise through futuristic cityscapes, or head off on an off-road adventure. So buckle up, Spatials, and let's get into it.
Okay, so I've got my car here that I've downloaded from CG Trader. There's a lot of different places I like to get my vehicles from, like CG Trader or Sketchfab or lots of other libraries that we'll link to in the description below. So I've got my car here in the scene, looking sick. And the first thing I'm going to do is put this on the vehicle layer. So we added this new feature here on the top right that takes advantage of Unity's layering system. So if I click on the effective layer on the dropdown and choose vehicles, and then click yes, this is basically just telling Unity and Spatial that this is a vehicle, so it doesn't conflict with any avatars or other objects in the scene. Okay, so once I have that, the next things I want to do is at the top layer of my vehicle, I'm just gonna add a rigid body. This is essentially what gives our vehicle physics. So we have here on our rigid body mass, drag, angular drag, and a few other settings. So for our mass, which is in kilograms, I'm gonna set this to 1,000 since this car weighs, you know, roughly 1,000 kilograms. And the other settings we'll leave as the default. Next, what we want to do is add a couple of interactables to the scene. So I'm going to right click, go down to spatial, and then choose interactable. So what this is going to do is allow us to walk up to the vehicle and enter it. So I'm gonna have two interactables actually. We're gonna have an start interactable, and then I'm just gonna command or control D to duplicate that and call this second one stop interactable. So what the stop one will do is once we're in the car, it allows us to exit the vehicle. So since we only want that to show up once we've already entered the vehicle, I'm going to uncheck that, and we're just gonna leave this as start and stop interactable. Under the start interactable, I'm just gonna change the interact text to drive. And we can have an icon type if you wanna have an icon next to that. I'm just gonna leave it empty for now. And then the radius, basically how far away we'll start to see that interactable button on screen. And I'm just gonna make this until we, you know, kind of walk up relatively close to it. So that's a good spot there. And for the stop interactable, I'm gonna change the text to exit. And I'm just gonna reactivate it briefly just so I can see the radius. And I'm just gonna make that size. And that's only going to show up, you know, again, once we're in the vehicle. The thing to keep in mind is where that shows up. Right now, you can see the icon there is kind of right inside the vehicle, so we won't be able to see that when we walk up to it. So I'm gonna just drag this up at the top here, so that way we can see the interactable panel, basically where it shows enter or exit, right at the top of the vehicle. So I'm gonna leave that there, and then deactivate the stop interactable. Now we wanna add the seats to our car, so we know where to place the driver in the vehicle. So I'm gonna right click on the vehicle and I'm going to create empty, and we're just gonna call this seats. And within seats, I'm going to create another empty object and we're just gonna call this driver seat. And there's nothing we need to add to this object. It just has to be an empty object with a transform with a position. And we're just going to put this where the driver's seat is. I'm gonna zoom in here and just click and drag up until we're in the approximate position where the avatar's butt will be basically. So I'm gonna put this about back there, and that's all we need to do for the driver's seat. We're just gonna focus on the driver's seat today and not passenger seats at the moment. Now to make sure that the vehicle collides with things as expected, it needs what's called a mesh collider, basically telling Unity and Spatial what the bounds of the vehicle are. We have the visuals, of course, so we can see what the chassis or the exterior of the vehicle looks like, but we need to basically say what's a solid object and what's not. So luckily, this vehicle already comes with a collision mesh. If yours doesn't, then make sure to choose what is the outer mesh of the vehicle. Or if it doesn't come with one of those, you can simply add a box collider to that as well. So to add a collision mesh, we're just going to take the mesh of our vehicle, in this case, the outer portion of it. And like I said, this vehicle already has a mesh collider, or excuse me, a collision mesh on the outside of the vehicle, basically what's identifying the outer part of the vehicle. So on that collision mesh, we're going to add a component and call and look for the mesh collider. And that adds that to the vehicle. And we want to make sure we click convex. It's very important that we click convex to the vehicle. And then you can see here that our collision mesh collider was added to the vehicle. That's that green outline here. The next thing we want to do is add a center of mass to the car. So just like any object that's moving through space based on its weight distribution, we won't get into the physics of it today. Every object has a center of mass, basically where that mass of the vehicle is centered around. So that'll determine if it falls over or if it might lean too far back or too far forward. So since this is a vehicle that's really low to the ground and has an engine at the back, there's gonna be a center of mass roughly, you know, in the back half of this vehicle. And sorry for all the physicists out there, if this is incorrect, please leave a comment down below and let me know where the appropriate place might be. But this is just a rough estimation. So to add a center of mass, I'm just gonna add another empty object. So right click on the top level of the vehicle and click create empty. And we're just simply gonna call this center of mass, and what exactly you name it doesn't really matter. And just like the seat object that we added to the scene, it just is an empty object with a transform, and we're simply moving this empty object into the right position. So I'm gonna add it roughly around here, because that's where the heaviest part of the vehicle, the engine block, is, and lower down since we're in a very low vehicle to the ground. And that's our center of mass. All right, now the next step is arguably one of the most important steps when setting up your vehicle, and that's adding wheel colliders to your car. Wheel colliders are similar to a rigid body or the mesh collider that you've added, but this is kind of both combined in the wheel aspect. So it tells Unity and Spatial how your wheel rotates, how heavy it is, and how it moves. So let's add those into your car right now. So I already have an area of my car called Wheels Hubs, which basically just has the transform set up for each vehicle, the front right, rear right, front left, and rear left. On each of these, I'm going to add a wheel collider. So if I click, let's start with the front right over here. If I click on that and then click add component and search for wheel collider, now I've added a wheel collider to my scene. And when you're in and editing your wheel collider, make sure that you have both the pivot handle selection selected and that you're in local mode instead of global mode. That's very important. So I have your wheel collider selected and then choose pivot and choose local. Now looking at your wheel collider, let's take a closer look at it here. You can see if you look closely, you see here this green circle surrounding your wheel is your wheel collider, with that kind of green sphere at the bottom being the bottom point of your vehicle. And we want to make sure that this is centered around your wheel and that that green outline gets as close and hugs that wheel as closely as possible. So first, let's get that radius of the wheel collider accurate. So if you look at the wheel collider, we have a radius variable. So we can either, you know, enter this manually. I could change this to say 0.4, that gets a little closer. Also, here's a little tip. You can click right on this property and slowly drag left and right to increase and decrease that variable. So we want to get a little closer. Let's try 0.35. that's getting pretty good. If we get closer there, you can see that green outline. We also want to make sure that the wheel collider is just about centered in our wheel here so that it rotates perfectly around our wheel. So you can see kind of this T, this cross section here, the line going across that green line. And then we have this little orange line in the center here. We want to make sure that that's centered on our wheel. So it looks about centered. Now let's get the radius just a little bit higher. So let's try 0.38 and 37. All right, that's looking, it's looking pretty good. This looks like this has to be raised up just slightly. We're getting close, we're getting close. I'm gonna try 0.375. Raise that up a little bit. Now you can see that that wheel collider is hugging our wheel here. All right, now the other thing we want to set is the mass. And this goes into the overall mass of the vehicle as well. So this is about, this is again in kilograms. This is about 20 kilograms. So I'm gonna leave that as the default for this wheel. We can look up what the exact mass of the wheel is later, but I'm gonna leave that as the default. And then we have other settings here as well. Everything from the suspension spring to the forward and sideways friction. These are all going to change depending on your vehicle. So also linked in the description below, we're gonna put the link to everything you need to know about wheel colliders and how you can determine what the settings should be for your vehicle. So for example, for the suspension spring, if you had a vehicle that was more of like an off-road vehicle or a Jeep, you would wanna raise the spring variables here as well. So it has more bounce in the spring. So now we have this setup for our wheel. The other thing to keep in mind is that this is has a forward position similar to the wheel mesh as well. So the forward position is this blue arrow here, the Z up variable. So we want to make sure that that's pointed towards the front of the vehicle, just like our wheel mesh. So here, this is pointed forward. That's great. Now let's take a look at our wheel mesh. So if I look here, we have our wheel front right. That's our wheel mesh. That's also pointed towards the front as well. Now, if you come into a situation where this isn't pointed forward to the right, say the mesh is turned to a different direction, what you'll want to do is actually give this a parent. So in this case is working, but I'll just as an example, right click and create empty parent. We can call this, you know, wheel. And we'll want to rotate it until that blue arrow is facing forward and make sure that it's aligned perfectly as well. So we'll want to make sure that this is in the center of where the wheel is. And we'll move this wheel back to the center here approximately as well. So that way both the parent is facing forward, so that'll make the wheel facing forward as well. And that ensures that your wheel rotates around the point that you'd expect. So again, when you set that up, make sure that that as well is set to pivot and local. In this case, we didn't need this, so I'm just gonna go and remove it. But for those who experience any issues with your wheel not spinning around the point that you would expect, that should solve that problem for you. Now that we have the wheel collider set up for that wheel, we're going to then set up the wheel collider identically to all the other wheels in the car. So I'm just going to go to each wheel here and give it a wheel collider. And we set this radius as 0.375. Now it's possible on a lot of vehicles, especially sports cars, the rear wheels tend to be just a little bit larger than the front wheels. So in this case, the radius might be a little bit larger. In this case, it looks to be about the same. And since it's a larger wheel, you want the mass to be just a little bit bigger. And we'll give this one just 21 kilograms as a mass since it's a little bit bigger. And then we'll go same thing on the front left. Give this a wheel collider. Set this as 0.375. make sure this is centered. Higher, there we go. And same thing on the rear. And raise that up just a little bit. And since this is the rear, we're just gonna give this slightly heavier at 21 kilograms. All right, so now we have our wheel colliders set up on our vehicle. Now, remember to keep in mind when you have your vehicle model that you have each of the wheels as a separate model so that they can turn independently. Sometimes car models have the wheel as a singular part of the entire model. If that's the case, you'll have to go into a tool like Blender to separate them out as a separate mesh. So like you can see here, this front right tire can be rotated independently so that when we turn the tire, it's turning separately and not the entire vehicle. All right, now let's bring this all together. So we have our wheel rig set up, we have the rigid body set up, we have the seat and everything else ready to go. So we have to bring it all together. So for that, we're gonna need some variables. We're gonna be using a little bit of visual scripting, but don't worry, we've got a sample already set up that we're gonna copy from. So first things first, let's go to the top level of our vehicle and let's add the variables component to it. We won't add anything into that now. So next thing we have to do is actually go over to our golf cart sample. So we actually provide that. If you download the latest version of the Creator Toolkit starter package, or if you go into the sample section of the Creator Toolkit, which we added recently, you can go download this golf cart sample that has everything all rigged up for you. So for example, we have it here and I actually already brought it into the scene. It's all set and ready to go. And you can see it has all of these variables set up. So let's just copy this over and then we'll have to configure the variables for our specific vehicle directly. So I'm just gonna click on the variables component here, these three little dots, and click copy component. And then let's go back to our vehicle, down to the variables that we added here, click on the top three buttons there, and let's click paste component as new. And you can see that copied all of that over. So this has everything we need. So first is the seat. This is the driver's seat that we added before. So let's click and drag the driver's seat from our vehicle over to the variables. And then these next couple, so is controlled locally, that's just a Boolean variable, which will come into play with visual scripting that just checks if it's being controlled locally. And then another variable is controlled that's checked if the avatar or the player has taken control over that vehicle. You don't have to worry about that right now. Next are the two interactables that we added earlier, start interactable and the stop interactable. So let's get those wired up. So let's take the start interactable and drop it in there. And then the stop interactable, or what we're using to exit the vehicle, and drop it under stop interactable. Don't change the variable names, but just make sure that you drag and drop in the different components and parts of the vehicle for your specific car. Next, we have drive, steer, and brake. So these are going to be the minimum values for your car, the drive speed, the steer angle, and the brake amount. So we're going to leave those as default because the vehicle is going to start at zero, of course. And then coming down, we have max drive, brake force, and max steer. So max drive, that's the torque of your vehicle. It's basically gonna set like what the max speed can be. That value is in Newton meters. Same for brake force, that's gonna be the maximum brake force on the vehicle. So we wanna make sure that that's set at least slightly beyond the max drive, also set to Newton meters. And then max steer, that's gonna be the angle, the maximum angle that your wheels can turn. So in a sports car, that's gonna be smaller than it would be in, say, you know, an off-road vehicle like a Jeep or something like that. So we're actually gonna change the max drive. We're gonna turn that up since this is copied over from our golf cart, which obviously goes a lot slower and is less powerful than the sports car. So let's tune this up a bit to 10,000. That's Newton meters. And then brake force, again, we wanna make sure that's higher than our max drive. So I'm going to set that to 11,000. And the max steer, we're going to leave that at 60 degrees in this case. Now coming down, we have our list of wheel colliders that we set up earlier. So let's make sure those are configured, and these go from front to back. It's important that these stay in that order, front to back. So let's go over to our car here and take first the front, do the front right, and then the front left. And then let's do the back right or the rear right and the rear left. Now it's important that those are in order, because now when we go down to the list of back wheels, you can see that we have this list of four spaces here, and the bottom two are what's checked. So what we're basically saying is the last two items in the list are the rear wheels. Now the last two items in this list, the list of all wheels that we've chosen here, are the rear wheels. So make sure that your rear wheels are the last two in the list. Now next up is our center of mass. Well, we've set that up earlier, right? That was that empty transform that we placed in the vehicle. So I'm just gonna click and drag that here. And then all wheel visuals. So that's the wheel meshes of our car, basically what's going to visually spin when the car is moving. So let's go back into our vehicle here and find those wheel meshes. So here, we have them over here. And again, let's make sure these are in the exact same order as the wheel colliders that we set earlier in our properties. So we're gonna start with the front right, and then the front left, and then the back right, and the back left. Great. Now coming down, the next thing we have is our camera target. This is going to be what our camera follows as we're driving around. So it's going to be, the camera is essentially going to change tracking the avatar, the character, and instead is going to track the vehicle. So you can set this to be a slightly different position than what the avatar is. So we can set that in our scene here as well. Now to create that, since we didn't create it yet, let's create another empty object. So I'm going to right click on our vehicle and choose create empty. And we're just going to call this camera tracker. And then clicking back in the top level, let's go back to our variables, scroll down, and I'm just going to take that object and place it here. Now let's make sure, since I just added it to the scene, I didn't actually move it yet. Let's make sure it's in the right position here. So now it's set to the bottom of our vehicle. We want the camera to focus on, and you'll see what this looks like, kind of a little bit to the back, you know, of the vehicle here. So we get a nice third person view of the vehicle itself. So we're gonna set that there. Coming right on down, list of properties. Next thing we have is honking. That's gonna come into play in the next set here, basically checking when the player hits the space bar, is the vehicle already honking? If it is, it's not gonna play a sound. If it's not, then it will play the honking sound, which you can use with your car. Coming down to the bottom of the list, gonna shift this over here. Now we can actually integrate sounds into our vehicle too. So you can have up to four different sounds. You can even integrate more than that if you'd like to, but what we provide through the visual scripting nodes is the ability to use four different sounds. That's a honk sound, the engine sound, basically what the idle sound is. The start engine sound, so when you get in the vehicle, the engine's starting up. And the stop engine sound, so when you exit the vehicle, what the engine sounds like when you turn it off. So let's add some of these to our vehicle. So we already have some here. These are being pulled from the golf cart, remember? And our sports car here is gonna sound a bit different than a golf cart. So we're gonna add the different sounds to the vehicle. So I'm gonna add another empty object to our vehicle, and we'll call this sounds. And then within that, we're going to add a few different objects here, create a couple empties. Let's call this horn, and another empty for vehicle engine. And then engine start. and engine stop. Now within each of these, we're going to add a audio component. Click audio source. We're just gonna multi-click to add all these at the same time. So I'm gonna just click and select, add component, and choose audio source. So we add that to each of them. And now we wanna add the horn audio file. So we already have this horn. We're gonna add the honk sound to our car. So I search for honk. This is an MP3 file I've already uploaded. And I'm just going to click and drag that to the audio clip and make sure play on awake is turned off. And then same for engine. I'm gonna choose this car engine sound, add that here, turn play on awake off. And then engine start, I have this car start sound. Turn play on awake off. And engine stop, we have this car stop sound. And turn play on awake off. All right, now that we have our sounds set up, actually the last thing I'm going to do with these sounds is make sure, you know, that their sound properties are, you know, what we'd expect. So first I'm going to change the spatial blend of these sounds fully to 3D. And that way they'll act as they do in the real world. The further away you are from it, you know, for other players, the harder it'll be to hear. And then I want to change the max distance. I'm going to change this to, this is in meters, changes to 15 meters. So you can see if I scroll out, this is how far away someone will hear the sounds of that vehicle. In this case, we're modifying all of them at the same time. So as I change this max distance further and further away like that, once the sound goes, or someone is outside of the circle, they won't hear the sounds anymore. So the closer they are to the vehicle, to the source, right at the center, the louder that sound's gonna be. So in a car, this is about, you know, I'd say the right distance for someone to hear the sound from the vehicle. So coming back into our vehicle, let's go back down to the sound files and let's align these up. So for our horn, I'm gonna take our horn object and drag and drop it there. For the engine sound, we have this engine idle sound. And then same for start, click and drag, and the stop sound. Awesome. All right, now there's just about one more thing we need to do to finish this up is, you know, we have these variables here and they're gonna come into play with our visual scripting nodes. So basically we have to tell the vehicle and tell Unity and Spatial how this all comes together. So to do that, we have to add visual scripting nodes. We're gonna add a script machine. Come down here. And we're gonna create a new one. And we're just gonna call this sports car graph. You can call this whatever you like, basically whatever would make sense to you as the file name. I'm gonna click save. And we have an empty visual scripting graph set up here. But we already have this all set up for you, so there's nothing you have to do. So let's go back to the golf cart. And then we have the script machine on the golf cart. I'm gonna click edit graph. And this is gonna open up. This is gonna open up the visual script node for driving. And we have this all set up for you. So let's go through this really quickly just so you have a little bit of a sense of what's going on here. You can see if I zoom out, there's all these different groups of nodes that are doing different things with the vehicle. And you're more than welcome to customize this. You know, if you're familiar or comfortable with visual scripting, definitely feel free to come in here and customize it. But right off the bat, this is what will get your car moving and working as expected. So first going into the setup node, I zoom in. Basically, this is just going to initially set up the vehicle. So we're gonna on start. So as soon as the scene starts, we're gonna get the center of mass that we set up, that was that variable, and set it to the center of mass of the rigid body. Then coming down, we have update the interactables and visuals. So we're going to make sure that the interactables that we set up, those buttons that allow you to interact with the vehicle, get assigned properly, and that the wheel visuals are updated and in their proper place. Now coming down, this is some of the more important aspects of what are happening here. When we enter and exit the vehicle. So we have our on interact, start interactable. So basically what's happening here is when someone interacts with that start interactable, when they walk up to the vehicle, press F or click on the vehicle to start and enter it and drive it. We have a subgraph here for entering the vehicle. Now we can take a look what that looks like by double clicking on there. And what's happening here is this is where our override nodes for Spatial come into play. So first, we're going to sit down. So you can see, if you remember before, we just set a transform for the seat position. We didn't actually put a Spatial seat, and that's because we're assigning that for you here. So when someone clicks on an interactable, the first thing that's gonna happen is where that seat position was, we're going to force override the avatar to sit down at that position. So they're gonna be in a seated position. And then we have an overrides node that's basically going to say the inputs that you normally use to move an avatar around, whether it's WASD or the arrow keys or the joystick on mobile or on VR. Now, those movement mechanisms are going to be applied to the vehicle in this case. So we're going to override the movement input, the jump input, and the sprint input, and we can now use those in reference to the vehicle. And then we're also going to override the camera as well. So we have this node for overriding where the camera is positioned. And in this case, we're going to position the camera where the camera target was set up. So remember, that was that camera target object that we assigned to the vehicle. So it's going to look more at the vehicle than at the avatar for a more natural look and feel. Then we have these last variables here that's going to assign the Boolean for is controlled locally and is controlled to true. So basically allowing the local user, the person who's driving the vehicle, to take control over it and have that synced across all for all the other players. We'll see that as well. So coming back out to this larger node, I just come down here. We have our sound effects. Now this is basically, we're getting into the weeds here, but what this is basically saying is syncing the honk and engine noise sounds to for everyone in the space. So it's gonna become a synced variable. But we'll get into synced variables and all those things related to multiplayer in a different video. But basically this is setting up the sounds so that everyone in the space can hear them. And then the last piece here, this is interesting, is updating the engine pitch and volume. So if you recall, we only added sounds for engine start, engine stop, the horn, and then basically an engine idle sound. So what we're doing here is taking that engine idle sound and changing the pitch of that sound based on how much the user is clicking, forward or backwards on the vehicle. So if I click on here, you can see it gets into the weeds a bit. We won't get too far into the details here, but basically what we're saying is we're taking the audio source that's playing that engine sound or that engine idle sound, and as the user moves forward in that space, we're getting the velocity of the rigid body of the vehicle, and we're increasing the magnitude of the sound to make it essentially sound like the car's moving faster, and same as the car slows down as well. So that's how we can effectively change the sound of the vehicle to make it sound like it's moving faster or slower, even though we're just using a single sound file. Now coming back out, if we look, I'm gonna come back to the top here. Now if we look at the braking node, this is basically taking the variables we put in place for brake and max brake, and allowing us to apply those to the vehicle. And then with steering and driving, long story short here is, again, taking the overridden move controls, forward, left, right, back, etc., and applying those to the vehicle itself. So allowing us to steer and move the vehicle. And then the last piece here is the horn input. So this is what is allowing us to honk the horn. So you can see here, starting in the top left, we're calling the on overridden jump node, which basically says when someone presses what's normally the jump button, which on the web browser is the space bar, or on mobile is the right input button. So you have the joystick on the left and the input button on the right. Instead of jumping, we're now going to apply that button to something else. So in this case, it's playing the horn sound. So we're gonna honk the horn with the space bar. Like I said, you can apply this to anything you want. You can have the space bar jump button give force to the vehicle, you know, or make an animation play, or really whatever you like. In this case, we're just playing a sound file. So that's how all this works in a nutshell. So we can take all this and apply it to our own vehicle too, without having to change anything. So I'm on a Mac, so I'm gonna hit Command A to select everything. If you're on Windows, you can hit Control A, and then Command C or Control C to copy everything. So now I've copied all of these nodes. Now let's go back into our vehicle and click Edit Graph under Script Machine. First, I'm just gonna get rid of these two default nodes. We don't need those. And I'm just going to Command V or Control C to paste everything that we went through just before. So now we have all these nodes. And since we already set up the variables before, like the max brake, etc., those are already all set up for us over here. So those are gonna get applied to our node graph over here. So I'm just gonna save that. All right, so the next thing we wanna do is make sure this vehicle is synced across everyone in the space. So that way when you move the car, everyone else sees the car moving as well, and all the different properties are synced across all the players in the space. So to do this, we're gonna add another component called the synced spatial synced object, and then make sure that sync transform is checked. And then let's click add synced variables. This is gonna draw from the variables that we pasted above. Now let's make sure that is controlled locally is synced. Drive, steer, and brake are all synced. And then lastly, is honking is synced. And once we click that, we're good to go. All right, the last thing we need to do is test this out to make sure it all works. So to set this up, let's go to the Creator Toolkit settings, and then let's create a new space. So we have create new and space selected. So click create, and we'll call this test track tutorial. And we want to make sure we choose this scene. So this scene is the track demo tutorial. And let's make sure we have a texture for the scene or an image. So I've already got a bunch uploaded here. Just find the right one. Choose this one. Once I've gotten that package set up, I'm just gonna go over here and click test active scene. You can see it says build the active scene track demo tutorial. So I know it's the right one, and click test and click continue. All right, here we are in our sandbox. And now you can see as I walk up to the car, I can click F to get in, and the engine sound plays, and now the interactable shows exit, and press F to exit. So when I do that, I'll get taken out of the vehicle, and the camera readjusts back to my avatar. When I get back in, The engine starts up and the camera repositions behind the vehicle. And now you can see when I rotate around, the camera is rotating more around the vehicle than around my avatar. And now I can click and move around. So I'm using the WASD keys to move the vehicle. And left and right. There we go. And I can press back to stop and exit. And there you have it. Now have a great time driving around your car in Spatial.
It's Brittany, bitch.